Good morning. It's a great pleasure, privilege to be here. But I start with an obvious disclaimer. I'm not an expert of what you're going to discuss today. And I was surprised when an invitation came to me to inaugurate a conference on a disease which I cannot even pronounce correctly. I was under the impression it was Alzheimer's, but I'm told today it is Alzheimer's. But then I'm equally recognizing the fact that I'm as vulnerable as anybody sitting here, of coming under this condition as I grow older. And therefore, it is a matter of great concern for all of us. It's not something that we have to be scared of. It's something that we have to be ready for. I'm glad that Dr. Chakrabani used the right word. It's a Alzheimer's-friendly city or nation that we have to build. I'm reminded of an old joke. Everybody wants to live long, but nobody wants to get old. When you live long, getting old is part of the business. And perhaps therefore, Alzheimer's is something that we have to live with unless our scientists and doctors and pathologists are able to find a breakthrough for that. I do not know much about this disease at all, except that I had the privilege and honor of being a caretaker for my father, whom I lost last year. He was not suffering from Alzheimer's, but he had certain other corollary problems. He had suffered from hyponatremia, which is the loss of sodium. And many of you, or any of you who have gone through, or who have had relatives who have gone through a hyponatremia, would recognize that their personalities change, at least subtly. And therefore, it was always a concern for us that my father doesn't slip into the Alzheimer's condition. So we were always watching. And for that purpose, I had done some little research, as any layman can do with the materials that are available on the public or the internet. And it was surprising to me that it's been a century and quarter after Dr. Alois Alzheimer, I hope I'm spelling it right, in fact recognized this condition in 1906. In fact, his curiosity was kindled when he saw an old lady, a patient, die of very strange behavior. The materials available would show that he put her brain to a test or to a scan and found that there were certain abnormal clumps and tangles in her brain, which I think the experts now call, I'm facing the experts, now call the amyloid plaque and the tau tangles and all that, the neurofibrillial the tangles. So that was how this was recognized. Now, when we talk about Alzheimer's, as a layman, I'm saying, I'm not speaking as an expert, of course, again, I'm putting the caveat on. When we speak of Alzheimer's, I think many of the citizens do not know what they are dealing with. A lot of misconceptions, a lot of wrong information floating around, maybe fortified by the movies that you see, certain characterizations that are more dramatic than they usually are. And there is a fear psychosis now attached to this. It is this that we may have to now tackle in conferences like this. Let people know what really is a disease. It is not a disease, it is perhaps a disorder. Just as you would age, your brain is also aging. Alzheimer's was generally considered to be a late onset disease after you become 60 or 70. And that's why I am confident that I have another maybe 10 years to go. I'm just about 51. But then we are also now aware of early onset Alzheimer's, of people getting afflicted even below this age. So this is not a disease that is age specific or old age specific. This is a disease that can afflict anybody, but the experience shows that late onset Alzheimer's is more common than the early onset Alzheimer's. I'm saying this because it is generally recognized internationally now that Alzheimer's is a combination disorder of health, lifestyle, of environmental factors, and genetics. Genetics, perhaps, there is nothing that we can do. We'll have to wait for the breakthroughs to come from the experts. But lifestyle, we can change. And I am broaching this topic only for one reason. Something that has always confused me, perhaps what this conference will send a message to the world. Is there a connection to Alzheimer's and sleep? Now this is important because on one side we have people who say that you should not sleep more than 3 hours or 4 hours. You're wasting your time. You're destroying your life. You can't spend 8 hours sleeping out of 24 hours that God has given you. I even saw a WhatsApp message, very interestingly, a couple of days ago, a very renowned spiritual leader on record saying that he sleeps only for 2.5-3 hours and that nobody should sleep beyond that. But then research on Alzheimer's, whatever little I have read, show that people who sleep less than 6 hours or 5 hours generally have a tendency for the buildup of the proteins, the amyloid and the tau. Now, is that a coincidence or is it only a, or does it even work in the reverse? That people who have these buildups of amyloid and tau, the tangles in your brain, they sleep lesser? Now, this is an important issue. I hope you will deal with it when you go with the conference today. Something that is confusing me. Personally, I like to sleep 6 hours and I'm not apologetic about it. I would like to sleep 6 or even more. 7, no problem. If I can sleep 8, why not? I will do that. I have the rest of the time for myself, for the world. For myself, it is at 8 hours or 7 hours. But personally, I sleep for about 6 to 7 hours. When I saw that WhatsApp message of this spiritual guru, I was slightly apologetic for about 2 minutes. Then I thought, doesn't matter. I sleep as much as I want to. My body tells me to sleep. So this is one thing that I was really concerned about because this is a lifestyle affliction also. If it is a lifestyle affliction, I hope this conference will deal with it and treat it as a lifeline, as a lifestyle affliction as you do with diabetes or blood pressure or whatever. Take this care out of this and tell the people what they are dealing with. The first time I read material on Alzheimer's, I think about 4 or 5 years ago for my father, I was really confused. The materials will tell you that this is because of your disorder in the hippocampus area of your brain, which is deeply embedded in your temporal lobe in each of the cerebral cortex, blah, blah, and all. You get scared. You do not know what is going to hit you. Now, this can happen to any one of us. So the conference, I hope, will deal with this suggestion that I'm making, that tell the people that this is more lifestyle. Genetics, of course, we can't help it. But then environmental factors and lifestyle, make a foray into a situation where you can explain this to the people from that angle. Please do that. And this is also important for the caregivers. As I was saying, I had the privilege of being a caregiver for my father for about 2-3 years. Again, he was not afflicted with Alzheimer's, but something, it's not a memory loss, but physically he had some issues. Now, it takes a lot of energy, it takes a lot of patience for the caregiver. The real hero is the caregiver. It is only if the caregiver is sincere in the approach that the patient will have some respite. Otherwise, when the disease takes its toll, the patient, I do not know the truth, but it looks as if the patient is in bliss, in kind of a second childhood, but it is a caregiver who then starts getting the hit. I have seen caregivers been driven to the hospital for both psychological and physical reasons. It's an extremely exhausting kind of a situation for a full-time caregiver. I hope this conference will also deal with that. I think you are doing it already. This is one angle that I hope the conference will be able to take for, and that makes this meaningful. It is not really important whether we sit together in this magnificent hall and discuss Alzheimer's threadbare. What is important is the tangible results that come out of it. I believe that if there is any conference, that conference must be meaningful with the results that it produces in the part after the conference. I hope this conference will become a meaningful one, and I hope you will do it for me because I inaugurated it. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your inspiring words, sir. Lawyers are the foot soldiers of the Constitution. Today, we have one with such successful career, Srimati Shalina V.G. Nair, the sub-judge and district secretary of DELSA, to do the presidential address. I request Srimati Shalina Vijay Nair to deliver the presidential address.